1 Peter chapter 2. Starting in verse 1, it says, "Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious." He's starting out, obviously, with this therefore in context of chapter 1. He talked about the blessings, the promises we have, the forgiveness, the grace, the hope of eternal life with God. For eternity. And he's been talking about these things, and so now he gets to this, therefore laying aside all malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking. And I want you to kind of look at this, if you would, as if he's saying, now that you're a new person, a new creation in Christ, it's time to take off these old garments that are filthy, that are gross, and it's time to put on these new garments that you've been given as children of God, and to walk as children of God. And so that's what he's calling them to, is it's time to lay these other things aside. These things that he mentions in specifically, malice, is like a general word for evil or wickedness. Deceit, cunning things intended to make us doubt or to dwell on sin by crafty plotting. It can be things that the enemy's using against us. It could be things we're trying to use to convince ourselves that something's okay. But that's what he's talking about by deceit, hypocrisy, pretending or acting to be genuine or to be honest. It's where we get the word actor in the English, and so we're supposed to be watching for hypocrisy. We should be genuine. Envy, jealousy, or ill will over the good fortune of others. This could be of possessions or of other people's success. And evil speaking, slander or evil reports that are not true about someone else or degrading them. Those are the things that he's saying. It's time to put those off. And when we read this list, I think we could all agree that, yep, those things don't have anything, any place in the body of Christ, and yet we should not have those in our lives. Yet we also, within that list, there's probably some level of conviction. And so why is it so difficult to put these things off? And the answer, of course, is because we have a sinful nature. We live in a fallen world. And we have our own nature we have to fight with. And there's also an enemy who is trying to plant thoughts continually in our hearts against the Lord and towards sin, towards ungodliness. It's often that when we want to fight against these sins, I don't think we fight always the right way. We'll come up and we'll have something on this list, And we will just go to it and we'll be like, you know, I just need to stop. I just need to stop. And it's very difficult to just stop a habit. And one of the most important things, and I think he goes into this here in verse 2, is habits need to be replaced. It's not just stopping something, it's replacing it with something better. And verse 2 says, "As newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious." Removing wickedness and partaking of holiness. Laying aside the lies and desiring the truth. If we simply try to stop something, if you've ever tried simply to stop, for me that's never worked. Of just trying to stop something, just like, I'm never going to do that again, or something of that nature. There has to be a replacement of something. Replacing it with something better. I remember hearing a story a long time ago about some sailors who were going through the Bermuda Triangle. And there was this story that everybody that went through, the reason they would all crash is as they get in there, that these mermaids, these sea demons, would come out and they'd sing this beautiful song, this mesmerizing song. And the sailors would become so fixed on it that they'd crash. They'd lose their way. And these people, as they'd go through, as they'd hear these stories, these reports, they'd go through determined, we're going to make it through, we're not going to listen to the music. They'd bring earplugs. They'd plug their ears. They'd know the song is coming, but at the same time, they'd just try to not pay attention, and one by one, they'd fall. Finally, a captain makes it through. makes it through. He sails right through. And somebody asks him, didn't you hear the mermaids? What happened? Didn't they try to get you? And he says, yes, their song came out and we heard it. And he said, what'd you do? He said, we went out and we sang a more beautiful song. That's what we did. And the story obviously is fictional, but it carries a truth. We cannot simply ignore the enemy's things that he throws at us, the lies from our own flesh and the lies of this fallen world and of the enemy. The darts are flying. What we have to do is we have to answer them with a more powerful truth. And we have to sing a better song. We can't simply just say no to this sin. We have to say no to this sin and replacing this with something that is a better thought, a better action, a better life. And so he's not just calling us here to put off the sin, but he's also calling us to put on holiness. And it's a two-part action. And often I feel that we can actually get caught up with good intentions, not that it's bad intentions, where we can try to be removing something in our lives, but we're not bringing in something godly to replace it. And when we do that, if you're like me, you'll notice that usually failure comes shortly after. The habit, the problem, the sin that you're facing is difficult to defeat until you bring in something of godliness, until you replace it with something from Him. So we can't defeat the enemy by just plugging our ears. We must have a better truth. And as he says here, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby. I've had a lot of kids that have been babies, right? And it's been a continual part of my life for the last 10 years or so. And so the idea of a baby desiring milk is fresh in my head. And when the baby wants milk, he lets you know, and he doesn't stop letting you know until he gets milk. Right? Nobody else will do. You can't distract them. A movie won't do. A toy won't do. Cheerios won't do. When they want mom, they want milk. They want, that's what they want, and that's all that they want. And he's using this for us to understand that we should be putting these things off, but we should be pressing in to the Word of God, pressing into this truth. And it says here, that you may grow thereby. God is bringing us to maturity. And the Word of God and His teaching are essential for Christian growth, just like milk is essential for an infant to grow, just like they need something of substance so that they can grow into a healthy young man or woman, so we also need the Word of God to grow spiritually. We need it. And within that need, we should also then have a desire, a spiritual desire. We have a lot of things that we can make priorities in our day. We have a lot of different things that can fill our schedules. And one of the reasons often I think people say that they're not reading the Word is they just don't have time. And I've shared this before, but one of my favorite things I've ever had passed to me is read before you eat. Feed your soul before you feed your stomach, and eventually you'll get in the habit of reading. By about lunchtime, you'll probably have it down. And it doesn't take very long when you make it a priority, when you make it important. And so be in the Word every morning and every evening. And not just because of some of trying to be religious, it's because we're desiring His input. We want to put off the old man. We want to be the new man in Christ. We're thankful that He allows us to walk with Him. We're thankful for the Word. We're thankful for the milk, for the spiritual food, for the nourishment. We have it right there. It's provided for us, and we should have hearts that are thankful and ready to receive it. The end of this verse, it says, if indeed you have tasted. You know, if you have experienced the satisfaction and the fulfillment, the strength that comes from being in the Word of God, the nourishment, the spiritual nourishment, if you have tasted that, then you know by experience that He alone can satisfy the soul. You know that. He alone can strengthen the soul. He alone can give you that strength to resist the sins and the temptations that come in your heart and your mind, and to be able to discern between the lies all around you. He alone can do that. And every Christian, that's what he's talking about here, who has been in the Word, who has tasted it, who has been a partaker of Christ, and when we read the Word, we're partaking of Him. If you've tasted it, you know that, and you don't know it by knowledge, you know it by experience. If you have been a believer, there has been a time where you have been strengthened in the Word of God. And he's saying, you know that by experience. Not only am I telling you it right here, but you already know because you have experienced when you were spiritually weak and you went to the Lord and he strengthened you. He gave you nourishment in that time. And we can each testify to this who spent time in the Word. I'll be the first to tell you, I know I need to be in the Word every day. And I need it every morning. I need it every night. Or I know I will be spiritually weak. But I want to be strong in the Lord. I want to be in the Word because I know it nourishes my soul. And that's the encouragement what he's given us here is put off these worldly deeds. But as you put them off, replacing them with godliness and nourishing the soul. So put off the flesh and build up the spirit. That's what he's calling us to here, that we might grow. Verse 4, coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble being disobedient to the word, to which they also were appointed. Remember right here, as he's talking about this, he's talking to Jewish believers who are scattered throughout the area. This truth is very much still relevant to us, but we want to just remember the context as he's talking to these Jewish believers that are scattered through modern-day Turkey. And each of these truths, I believe, is just as relevant to us as Gentiles as it is to the Jews. But there's also a few statements out of here that we'll take out of this chapter that I think we'll see that he's specifically here talking with Jewish believers predominantly in mind. With that, again, the Old Testament is the writings of the Jews and a lot about the Jews, and we learn a lot from it. So don't turn your ears off because I say that, and you go, well, I'm not Jewish. No, no, there's still important lessons for us to grab out of it. We just want to grab them within the right context. Now, the Old Testament has hundreds of prophecies about the Messiah, the coming one, the promised one, the Christ, the Savior of the world. And right here, Peter highlights three different passages about the coming Messiah. Isaiah 28:16, Psalm 118, verse 22, and Isaiah chapter 8, verse 14. And he's listing those as he's going through this quote. And in Zion is a few things. We're going to grab some things of the main things he's talking about, these prophecies that were written hundreds of years before Christ came that were telling us who he would be and what he would do. And so first it says, in Zion, a Jewish stone. That's what that's referring to. In Zion is a reference to either Israel or to Jerusalem specifically. And so the first part of this stone is it's from Jerusalem. That's part of the prophecy. And it's a chief cornerstone. It's elect, it's precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. He is the chosen one, he's the precious, and he's precious to all those who have been saved by him. And how true that is, that he is precious to us. Who is more valuable to you than Jesus Christ? Who has ever loved you more than Jesus Christ? Who would you rather have in your life than Jesus Christ? He has become the most precious to all those who come to know him as Lord and King, as Savior. He is the most precious of all of the different possessions or relationships we've ever been given. But he's also the chief cornerstone. A chief cornerstone is a stone that they would set, and then it was the corner of a foundation, and the rest of the building is set off of it. Our building processes today, they're a little bit different, but they carry the same exact concept. Today we do a survey of a property. Typically after you survey the property, you set a point on the building, a corner, and from that corner you measure out and give the rest of the building. You set all the rest of your corners and angles based on that one that you set. And the idea here of this chief cornerstone is it is the chief one, it is the first one of which all measurements go out. That's Jesus Christ. And if something is off somewhere, you go back to your first point, this chief cornerstone or the corner that you started from, and you remeasure all your angles till you find where your mistake is. That's how you check and make sure your foundation is good. And once the foundation then is complete, or the preparation is complete, the foundation is poured, and then your boundaries are now set to build the structure. And so Christ here is the reference of the chief cornerstone. He is the measurement then of all Christian doctrine. If ever something looks off, we go back to the Word and we examine, we measure it back till we find the error based on the teaching of His Holy Word, and then we correct accordingly. He's the chief cornerstone. This is a significant thing because if we get these things wrong, we can end up on the wrong structure. We can end up building the wrong things. We're building things that are built incorrectly. And both the foundation as a whole and the chief cornerstone, they're both really symbolic of Christ and His Word. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20 says this, "Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone." So from Christ is where all measurements start that lay the foundation. This is the foundations of the Christian faith, of salvation, of how you can enter into a relationship with God. And on that foundation, from that point, comes the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. What is that? That is the Word of God. It's a reference to the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament is the prophets. And the New Testament is the apostles. It's why the Word of God, what we call the canon at times, meaning the books that have measured up to being the inspired Word of God, they closed with the end of the apostolic age. The eyewitnesses of Jesus Christ recorded the New Testament. And when that period closed, the inspired Word, not that God doesn't speak to us, but why don't we ever add to the Bible, is because that closed the canon. It closed the inspired Word of God, is that He spoke through the prophets and then through the apostles. The foundation now is laid. Now we're building the structure. That's why we don't come back and try to add to the foundation. And Christianity is based upon these two points, upon Jesus Christ Himself and the Word of God, which of course is a reference back to Jesus Christ Himself. This is a sure foundation that we can build upon. One that has been tested through time, one that can be measured and checked, and that can withstand any storm. But something we should also be careful to do, and that we should learn, and we should even learn it carefully from the Jews, is we need to be careful that we don't build upon a different foundation. There's not a perfect church out there. Every church is full of sinners who have been saved by the grace and the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how every one of them that's a believer, got saved. But as you are looking at things within ministry or churches, I'm thankful you're here. I'm not asking you to leave. But I also recognize God brings people to churches in different places for seasons of time. And perhaps someday He moves you to a different body or a different location entirely. And something I want to encourage you is always find one with a solid foundation that is being built upon the foundation that was already laid, which is upon Jesus Christ and His Word. That's the foundation to be building upon. That's the measurement. How do we know if something's right or wrong? If you start measuring from different corners, different reference points, the whole building gets out of whack really quick. And all of a sudden, it's very hard to tell anything. Well, is this right or is that right? Well, how did you get so off? Well, let's go back to the first corner, the chief corner, and let's start measuring out, and we'll find the error. We'll find it quickly. But if we abandon that as the reference point, we can end up who knows where. We can end up all over the place. And we're seeing that, I think, often with ministries or churches in our time. They're not building upon this foundation. And therefore, they're not actually building anything that is going to stand. When the storm comes, when it hits a building built upon this foundation, it will stand. But if you build upon a different one, it won't stand. And not only is that important for the church, we can see that within Israel. When they're following God, they as a nation, they stand. As individuals, you can stand. And as a church, as a group of people, this is how we will stand or fall. It's based upon the foundation on which we're building. I also would encourage you to check the foundation of any ministry you're a part of or supporting. There's a lot of different ministries we can be a part of that are outside of just of our church body. There's a lot of great ministries, but there's some of them also that in time they get off base. And they get off base because they're no longer measuring back to the chief cornerstone, to Jesus Christ, and they're no longer concerned about building upon the foundation. Now they're getting more concerned about, well, how is this going to make us appear to our donors? And now we're measuring to a different base. How is this going to affect attendance? Well, now we're measuring to a different base. Those are the wrong bases. We should be measuring to Jesus Christ and His Word. That's the measurement. That's where we go back, and that's how we know if we're building in the right place. That's how we know if we're building upon the right foundation. And this is a crucial thing. You know, you build a building in the wrong spot, and it's a big problem. I've seen it done a few times in different places. It usually ends in lawsuits. That's how it goes. It's not beautiful. It doesn't make a great thing. It's a terrible thing. And so it's a significant thing is that when you go to build something, that the foundation is put in the correct place. If it doesn't have the correct setbacks, you may never get a certificate of occupancy if you don't meet the different restrictions that are put in place by the city. These are big deals. And the same, they're true for us also spiritually. If we start ignoring this foundation and just building random things, we're just building a house of cards that's going to fall. It's not going to meet approval when God comes around. And so we want to build and invest upon the foundation that has already been laid. And we want to take all doctrines and we put them back and we measure them back to Jesus Christ. And we want to take all the different truths, all the different traditions, all the different things. We're measuring back. We go, no, what is the foundation that was laid through the apostles and the prophets, the Word of God? And that's why we give it such authority in the church, is because we don't want to get off base. This is the foundation. And it's not the way we do it. I'm thankful we get to be a part of Calvary Chapel. I'm thankful for the layout that we have, that we go chapter by chapter, the different things like that. But the important factors, if you're building upon the true church, is this: Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone, and is the foundation the Word of God? Or are you measuring to some other means? And so I encourage you, each ministry you're a part of, each church you're ever a part of, look for this foundation. I encourage you today, any ministry that you're supporting, if you were to look at it and the way that what they're doing, is this true of the ministry that you're supporting? If it is, then thank you. Thank you, Jesus, and continue to support it, and continue to build upon it. And if it's not, then invest your time and your resources upon a sure foundation. If you had an opportunity to invest in a multi-billion dollar property with a bad foundation, would you jump in? No. If you had your opportunity to jump into a house, there was a few $100,000 opportunity, but you came in and it's like, it's a bad foundation, would you just assume all the risk? Or would you want to make sure the foundation's reasonable before you start putting finances behind it? Would you want to make sure it's not going to have to be demoed? Those are big deals. And it's even more so within building things spiritually, that it's founded upon Jesus Christ and upon His Word. He also says, he who believes on Him will by no means be put to shame. Anyone who builds upon this foundation that has been laid can be sure that when they get through life, they'll be thankful for the way they spent it. They will not be ashamed when they go and stand before God Almighty. All those who place their faith in Christ, we know will inherit eternal life and not judgment. And that's overall, I think, what the reference here is to the shame. But we also are given the grace of God, and we begin to build upon this foundation, of course, by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And he who believes on Him will by no means be put to shame. In other words, we should have such great confidence in the foundation that we're going that we should have no worries about anything the world says, because when we stand before God, if our confidence is here, this is what we're building upon, we'll be in good standing. And that's where we should be concerned. We shouldn't be concerned with the co-worker over there saying. We should be concerned when the boss, when we go to stand before the boss, is he going to be happy? And that's the way we should be looking at it. And he's letting us know, he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Verse 7, therefore to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. You know, again, he is the most precious to those who believe in him, those who have come to know him. We have never experienced greater love, greater mercy, or greater grace than we have found in Jesus Christ. But the builders rejected him. Who is this? This is the Jewish leadership and the Jewish people that rejected him. Why? Because they were appointed to be the light of the world. They're supposed to be the ones who bared the oracles of God to the world. But they were the builders. And they rejected him. And this is all prophetic. These are things that were written about Jesus Christ and that he'd be rejected. This is, again, an important warning for us. What happened to the Jewish people when they rejected the foundation? What happened to them? Did it work out good for them? Was it a good choice? And these are lessons we can learn, though we're not the Jewish people. We can learn them as the church. What do you think will happen to the church if we try to build on a different foundation? I think the same exact thing that happened to the Jews will happen to us. Now, God's still not done with the Jews, and we'll get into that more as we get into the text this morning. But here, these people were the priests and the teachers of the Word of God, and yet they rejected the most essential piece of the project. That's what they rejected. They wanted the structure and different things, but when God brought in Jesus Christ, and here's the chief spot, we all measured, they said, no, no, we reject that. We want nothing to do with it. Another word for their rejection is that they disapproved. They disapproved of Jesus Christ as being the chief cornerstone. No, we will not measure back to him. And that's what they did. And there is a warning to us as the body of Christ. Do not grow arrogant against God, even if his plans unfold different than you thought they would. You submit and go along. That's the lesson for us. Because it says that they stumble being disobedient to the word which they were also appointed. What a gift that they were appointed to it, to teaching the word of God. And what a warning to stay cautious to not get off base. There have been a lot of great ministries. Actually, you can do the same thing. You can look at that they had phenomenal beginnings. But at some point, they can get off base. You can see that within the Word of God. There are people who had bad beginnings and ended up as very, very strong believers. There are people who had good beginnings and then they finished not good at all. And we want to finish strong. We want to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. Verse 9, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praise of him who called you out of darkness into marvelous light, who once were not a people, but now are the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Let's go through some of these terms. Generation means like a race of people, a lineage, or kind. This is from the Greek, of course. Royal priesthood means that these people, they're according to the order of Melchizedek, but it's also promised to them back in Exodus chapter 19. A holy nation, though they were the, we are the people of God. I also believe that this here is a reference to the nation of Israel. That's, again, an Old Testament term. His own special people, that's also a familiar term out of Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6 and 14, verse 2. These people, it says, they're appointed that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. There's a lot of overlap between the church and the Jewish people. And we're going to try to draw some of that out of here this morning. But the Jews were called to be light bearers just as we, as the church, are. And as we draw some of the things, again, out for the Jewish people, it doesn't apply to us. I'm trying to think from Peter as he's writing this, as the Spirit's inspiring him, to the Jews that are scattered in Turkey. How is this being received, and for what intent and purpose is it being written? Now, most scholars, I will tell you, look at this as probably predominantly to the church. I look at it as predominantly to Israel, though having influence still for the church, that it's predominant, actually is written to these Jewish believers. Why do I think that? Well, one, the letter is addressed to them. Two, Peter is the apostle to the Jews. Three, all of these terms here have Old Testament references or titles of Israel. And four, I think the Jews reading it at the time when it was written would have seen it that way, is that it was applying to them, not necessarily to the church as a whole. Written from Peter to them, I think that's the way they would have interpreted it as they were reading it. So that's my thoughts. Again, it has complete overlap. The meaning, the purpose, we can build elsewhere also in Scripture. These things apply to the church, but I think he's talking to the Jews. Why do I think it's important to draw that out? Well, for one, I don't believe God is done with the Jewish people. I think he's still doing things with them as far as a bloodline goes. When we read through the Old Testament, we can learn a lot about a country. We can learn a lot about right and wrong, righteous judgment. But he's not talking, when we get in the Old Testament, we know he's not talking about the United States. The country he's dealing with always is Israel. It doesn't mean the truths that he's teaching don't apply to the United States. It just means we want to understand the context that who he's talking to is Israel. And what I'm trying to draw out within these different parts here is the context. He's talking with these Jewish believers. There's value for us in the lessons, a lot of value for the lessons. We can see the same thing with the Old Testament. Some people, of course, are trying to get away more from the Old Testament nowadays. And the Old Testament is loaded with value for the church. We have several things. Some we've already talked about. But some of the things we can see clearly in the Old Testament, if we stray from the Word of God, it's all downhill, as individuals or as a nation. That's continually played out. Even if you're from a certain bloodlines or certain family or different things, it doesn't matter. If we trust in God, he is faithful and abundant in mercy. What else can we learn from the Jewish people? It doesn't matter if you come from a great Christian family. You need to place your faith in Christ yourself. These are lessons that are taught within the different things that we can clearly see throughout the Old Testament. What else do we see throughout the Old Testament? We see the nature of God displayed, that he's incredibly faithful and loving. We see those things. It's generally portrayed on the nation of Israel, on the people of Israel. But it's also teaching us about the nature of God as he lets us look upon the way he's dealing with these people. And he's doing it in 1 Corinthians 10, talks about even a lot of that with the Exodus, that it's recorded for our learning. And so as we read about these different people, even if they're Jewish, the lessons are still just as true for us. But I do believe it's important that we also still recognize God has some plans and he has some promises still for Israel. And when we read it, we just want to have the correct perspective, the correct context for how it was intended to be read. Here he says some of the things about them. He says, who once were not a people, but now are the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Of course, we can read that, and that's true of the of us as the church, but it's also true of the Jewish nation. God formed them. They didn't form themselves. God formed the nation of Israel. They were not a people, but now they are the people of God. These people who had not obtained mercy, this is also still a reference to these people. Even though they were Jews, they didn't become saved until they placed their faith in Jesus Christ. And so that's a reference, I believe, also to them locally. Does it have things that apply to us too, overtones that clearly play to the church? Absolutely, it does. But also, it's a reference here to Israel, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Verse 11, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. With the word Gentiles there, most scholars would just interpret that as referring to non-believers. I'm looking at it as he's writing to Jews, that they're actually thinking of Gentiles as people who are non-Jew. But either way, we're going to grab now the main points out of what he's talking about. Abstain from fleshly lust. You know, I read that, I thought, well, thank you, Lord, not a single person in our church struggles with that. That'd be nice, right? No, we all war against the lust of the flesh. and it wars against our soul. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. It says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. You know, there's a war, and it's constantly going on inside us, and it's got two different desires. There's our spiritual desires, the one that desires righteousness, and the other desires lust, the passion of the flesh. And they're constantly at odds with each other. They're constantly fighting each other. And we need to walk in the Spirit to fight against the flesh, meaning walking with God daily and being about His business. That's what it means. And that means we need to be in the Word, and we need to be on our knees every day. We need to be focused on loving God, on building up His body, and reaching the lost. That's where we should be. These battles that take place within our flesh, you know, we can go right back to the beginning with all the different things that he listed to abstain from, the things to put off, the garments not to wear. And we can look then at the things that he's telling us to put on, to desire the pure milk of the Word. And, you know, one of the things that we still so struggle with the lust of the flesh is the simply just from abstaining instead of replacing. And it needs to be replaced with something superior. It's not just a denial that we're not going to have that. We're not going to have that because we're going to have this. We're going to have this relationship with Christ. We're going to grow stronger in Christ. We're going to grow closer to Him. We're going to trust Him that His ways are better. We're going to find strength in our relationship with Him. And so I really encourage you within this war that's within you, feed your soul so that it has the strength to fight against the flesh. In Galatians, where it says, these are contrary to one another, so you do not do the things that you wish. You know, I feel at times as believers, when you get to a lukewarm place at all, if there's a place where you're not really fully trying to follow the Lord, but you're also not having freedom in your flesh, you have a conscience that's not allowing you to go this way, there's no satisfaction. You're sitting there on the fence. And they're contrary to one another. And not satisfying either of them isn't the answer. The answer is finding complete satisfaction in Jesus Christ. That's the answer. And you have to plug in. And if you're not finding that satisfaction, if you're not building up the soul, the flesh will come in. Those desires will continue to grow. We will continue to battle that sin nature, and we need to invest in our souls and look to Jesus Christ to be the strength that we draw strength from by being in His Word, by hearing from Him, and by trusting in what He has said. And these are essential for us in this battle against sin, against the lust of the flesh. We're going to go ahead and we're going to stop there this morning. We're going to pick up in verse 13 next week. So I'm going to go ahead and close us in a word of prayer. Lord, I thank You this morning for Your Word. Lord, I pray, Father, that You would help us, Lord, to stay away, Lord, from the things that bring death and pain into our lives. Lord, the former things of the flesh. Lord, I pray, Father, that now that we are new creations, that we'd be built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ and Your holy word, Lord. Lord, that we'd put off the old garments and that we'd put on the new, Father, that we'd be in Your word faithfully, Lord, being strengthened by You. Lord, that we'd build each other up, that we'd be bold witnesses to the lost, that we'd be about your business, Lord, that we would continually live in the satisfaction, Lord, of Your love and of the relationship that comes from You, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for the nourishment that You've provided. Thank You for the strength that You have provided. Lord, I pray, Father, that You'd help each of us, Father, to resist the temptations, Lord, within the flesh, to strengthen our spirits, Lord, that we would joyfully trust in You. Lord, that when those temptations come, Father, that they'd be met with a more excellent truth. Thank You, Lord, for Your word, for Your truth, Lord, that gives us strength to fight these different things. In Jesus' name, amen.